Good evening, everyone. On behalf of CATS, I welcome all the speakers and each one of you to the Play Story session of Festival of Places 2020-21, jointly hosted by Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, IGNC, New Delhi, and CATS. The Festival of Places is an initiative of CATS, a not-for-profit organization working in the area of heritage conservation, management, and advocacy since 2001. We have been working with a vision to highlight local heritage assets, empower local communities, and make heritage conservation participatory and sustainable. An effort such as ours requires technical and financial assistance as well as patronage. You can support and participate in our multiple initiatives and programs by volunteering your skills and contributing financially. Do visit our website www.indiaheritagehub.org or write to us at info@catsindia.org for more details. We at CATS feel very strongly about the dismal state of public spaces in our cities and firmly believe change in the way we think, talk, and use public spaces can only begin at the grassroots by creatively engaging people with places and empowering them to make a difference to the places and spaces around. The Festival of Places is an idea born out of the spirit of volunteerism to come together, collaborate, co-create, and celebrate places that nurture health, happiness, and foster community living. The festival aims to bring people, places, and memories and their interrelationships at the forefront of public discussion. It envisions to investigate places, the people who inhabit them, the collective and individual memories that are integral to places, and present them in a new way to leverage discussions on the future of public spaces. The festival provides an opportunity to people for sharing their personal narratives. Moreover, the festival aims to help discover the much overlooked human dimension of spaces. The main highlight of the festival this year is Play Stories, a series of online storytelling sessions that help understand the hidden dimensions, multiple interpretations, and varied memories associated with places, highlighting their distinct characteristics, as well as unraveling the bond that people have with them, a connection that lives through their experiences. The storytelling sessions by professionals, scholars, and students from diverse fields focused on public spaces have been planned around the theme of exploring memory in places. In our last Play Story session, we headed up north to Punjab and discovered Dakhni Sarai, the hidden gem of the bygone era. Our storyteller for the session took us through the lush green landscape of Punjab, and the place expert for the session unraveled the unique cultural landscape around the historical Sarai, traveling along a very special and important road, the Badshahi Sadak. The title of today's Play Story is The Legacy of Maharaj Bada. The public spaces in Maharaj Bada for some are a source of their livelihood, a place to transact business for others, it is a place for shopping, and for still others, a place for social interaction and being part of the throbbing public life in the city. Our Play Storyteller for the session, Ms. Rashi Chawla, will be taking us into the historic core of Gwalior to witness the daily life of the residents of the city unfold within the historic Maharaj Bada in all its glory. The place expert for the session, Ms. Smita Singh, will take a deeper look into the historic bazaar and explore the connections that people from all walks of life have with the place. The place resident, Mr. Jay Khande, will share his personal experiences and memories of the place, having lived there for years. Our Play Storyteller, Rashi Chawla, grew up in Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh, and graduated from Little Angels High School, Gwalior. She's currently a second-year student enrolled in Sushant School of Art and Architecture's Bachelor of Architecture program in Gurugram. She's an ambitious and passionate, self-motivated individual, having interests across a variety of fields like fine arts, architectural design, marketing, graphic designing, and craft work. She's a team player and is actively involved in various activities across fields of design and art. Our place expert, Ms. Smita Singh, is an urban designer and urban planner from the School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi. Her work experience of over 17 years spans diverse areas, including planning policy review, local area and site planning, real estate, governance, and finance with both the public as well as the private sector. She is currently in the process of developing a collaborative research-based urban design and planning practice and is visiting faculty at the Department of Physical Planning at SPA, New Delhi. Our place resident, Mr. Jay Khande, is the founder of Godinga.com, a travel and event company, and he is an old resident of Gwalior. We now begin our conversation around Maharaj Bada, and I invite Rashi to please present her play story.
Good evening, everyone. So I grew up in Gwalior, like ma'am just described about me, and I have been connected to Maharaj Bada a lot. So when this idea of play stories came to me, the first thing that struck to me is Maharaj Bada. And I would like you all to see how I have seen it while growing up in Gwalior.
Yeah. So basically, Marajwada, an oval-shaped market, is built by the Sindhias with the elements of Victorian, Greek, Roman, Gothic and Indian architecture. So now we'll go through all of these places individually, starting with the first thing that we can see when we enter the market is the roundabout, which has this peculiar statue of Jivaji Rao Sindhia first and hence exerts dominance over the entire place while providing a proper movement of vehicles around it. Now coming to the second spot, which is the town hall. By the way, my favorite one. I mean, look at it, yaar. How can one not fall in love with the detailing? Well, my dadi has one very special memory attached. So I'll take this over to her. You might enjoy this.
40 years old. मेरे को मैरिज करके आएंगे जब से ले गई. तो भाड़ा तो मेन सेंटर ही है, तो सब कुछ कुछ भी लेने के लिए मेन भाड़ा ही जाना पड़ता है. कोई मार्केट सब वहीं है, आसपास ही सब. पूरा शहर ऐसा लगता है कि पूरा वहाँ की बिल्डिंगें भी सब ऐसे लगते हैं सिर्फ हिस्टोरी का, सब एक कलर की, पिंक कलर की बनी हुई है.
हाँ,
स्टोन्स लगे हैं मतलब पिंक कलर के. और पहले ज़माने के, पुराने ज़माने की बड़ी बड़ी बिल्डिंग है, उन्हीं को रेनोवेट करके सब, किसी को बैंक बना दिया है, किसी को पोस्ट ऑफिस बना दिया है. पहले जो ये रीगल ये था, अभी टाउन हॉल जो है वो कभी उस ज़माने में कभी रीगल टॉकीज़ के नाम से था. वहाँ पे मूवीज चलती थी, हम खुद गए मूवी देखी है. वहाँ से निकले तो मुझे एक आशा नाम की पिक्चर थी, हम देखने गए थे, मुझे याद है. मैं अपने मॉडल लॉक थी तो माता रानी का गाना था, उसमें दिखाने के लिए उनको अपने साथ ले गई थी. मैं जब भी वहाँ से निकलती वो मुझे याद आता कि मैं कैसे अपने मॉडल लॉक को लेके आई थी यहाँ पे.
नाउ coming to the third spot, which is the Victoria Market. Victoria Market was built in 1910 in honor of Queen Victoria. The building celebrated its 100 years of existence in 2010. But unfortunately, in the same year, on 5th June 2010, a major fire broke out, leading to the current state. This building was used as a stationary market, but then due to these unfortunate events, shopkeepers had to shift to another part of the city. The building is an amalgamation of Mughal, Rajput and colonial styles. It is rectangular in plan with a central arched opening flanked by three bays of arcades on either side. Restoration work has started since then. Now, my dad told me an interesting story about his experiences at Bada.
जितने भी काम करने वाले लोग हैं, जो घर के घर मजदूर बनाते हैं, जो घर बनाते हैं मजदूर लोग होते हैं, वो सब सुबह यहाँ आते हैं. पूरे शहर के मजदूर यहाँ मिलते हैं, जहाँ काम करने के लिए आदमी को लेने आता है. यहाँ पर काफ़ी सारी बिजनेस एक्टिविटीज़ होती हैं. बेसिकली ये सेंटर ऑफ द सिटी है. यहाँ पर कई लोगों का बचपन भी गुजरा है, बड़े भी हुए हैं, बूढ़े भी हुए हैं. मेरा ही बचपन ही गुजरा है. वो बचपन की यादें आज भी याद आती हैं. जब हम यहाँ आते थे, वो पापा के साथ स्कूटर पे आना, वो डाक खाने से डाक ले जाना, सहरन का सुबह 10:30 बजना, सिनेमा हॉल में पिक्चर का लगा देखना.
Now the fourth spot is the Sarafa Bazaar. When I went there, I had a conversation with a lot of businessmen who elaborated the nitty-gritties that go into making this place so functionable.
Basically, it is called heart of the city, Sarafa Bazaar, surrounding Bada.
तो यहाँ पे एरिया में इतना ज़्यादा क्राउड क्यों है? मतलब
शहर का सबसे बिजीएस्ट इलाका कहलाता है सराफा बाज़ार और महाराज बाड़ा, जहाँ पे लगभग सारे प्रकार की चीज़ें उपलब्ध हैं. तो इसलिए कस्टमर को जो भी चॉइस चाहिए वो सराफा बाज़ार और बाड़े पे आके फुलफुल रहती है, तो इसीलिए फुटफॉल ज़्यादा होता है.
तो यहाँ के जो रोड्स हैं, पूरा अरेंजमेंट है कि यहाँ पे टोपी बाज़ार है, यहाँ पे सराफा है, वो कैसा है?
ये बहुत पुराना स्टेब्लिशमेंट है, मेरा ख्याल है 50 से 60 साल पुराना ही होगा, और ज़्यादा भी हो सकता है. महाराज बाड़ा तो काफ़ी पुराना है यहाँ पे, और इसके सराउंडिंग 3-4 मार्केट और लगती हैं जहाँ पे फुटफॉल बहुत ज़्यादा है. यहाँ पे सारी वैरायटी अवेलेबल है, और ये हेरिटेज बिल्डिंग भी है यहाँ पे पुरानी, इसलिए फुटफॉल ज़्यादा है.
तो ट्रैफिक का कैसा रहता है यहाँ पे?
ट्रैफिक का थोड़ा कंजेशन है यहाँ पे, जिसमें थोड़ी सी हमारे को सुधार की आवश्यकता है. आई होप गवर्नमेंट धीरे धीरे स्टेप लेगी और आगे इसमें सुधार करेगी.
धनतेरस पे कैसे मनाते हैं?
धनतेरस पे तो जो सराफा बाज़ार की साज सज्जा होती है, शहर में कहीं भी नहीं होती है. वो सबसे बेस्ट सराफा बाज़ार में ही होती है. लेकिन दिस ईयर, पर्टिकुलर दिस कोरोना ईयर में कुछ प्रॉब्लम सामने आई हैं जिनकी वजह से धनतेरस में भी इफेक्ट रहेगा, वो फुटफॉल नहीं मिलेगा जो पिछले 50 सालों से मिल रहा है।
सच हार्ड वर्किंग पीपल, थैंक यू वेरी मच। नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू एंटर द फिफ्थ स्पॉट, दैट इज टोपी बाजार। हाउ टू डिस्क्राइब इट? वेल, आई थिंक इफ इट वॉज अ पर्सन इट वुड बी जैक ऑफ ऑल ट्रेड्स। Now, some local businessmen of Topi Bazaar were kind enough to tell me the insights of this place.
आप यहाँ पर कितने साल से हैं?
मुझे 35 years से मुझे हो गए।
आपने कितना चेंज होते हुए देखा इस बाड़े को, कल्चर सब कुछ?
मैंने एक बार देखा है कि यहाँ पर शासन प्रशासन ने पार्किंग की व्यवस्था कुछ नहीं की है। उन्होंने हमेशा ये कोशिश की है कि यहाँ से बिजनेस व्यापार क्लब्स हो, जितने लोग आए वो परेशान हो, इस साइड आए ही नहीं। तो आप देखिए कि अब अभी आज दीपावली का समय है और कितनी बुरी हालत है यहाँ पर। मैं समझता हूँ कि अगर 500 लोगों में 350 दुकानदार है, भाड़े पर एक एक फुट में दुकानदारों को बिठा दिया गया है, तो ये कहीं से भी है ना एक सिस्टमेटिक नहीं है। मतलब कोई भी अच्छी जेंट्री, अच्छा कस्टमर बाड़े आने से मना करता है। गाड़ी की पार्किंग की प्रॉपर अरेंजमेंट नहीं है यहाँ पर, कभी भी गाड़ियाँ उठी जाती हैं। तो अव्यवस्था है। शासन प्रशासन ने तो बहुत कोशिश की है कि लोग बाग बाड़े पर नहीं आए।
अच्छा,
इतना होने के बावजूद भी बाड़ा अपने आप में इतना ग्लैमरस है कि लोग फिर भी आते हैं। और यहाँ पर बिजनेस का जो रिटेल होलसेल का जो सिस्टम है, आपको कुछ भी चीज चाहिए थैला उठाओ पैसे लेके आओ, वो बाड़े पे आपको हर चीज मिल जाएगी, हर चीज। तो इसका ग्लैमर ना खत्म हुआ है ना हो पाएगा,
बस थोड़ा अगर सिस्टम से काम हो जाए तो।
वो तो मेरे हिसाब से तो सिस्टम तो दूर की बात है, कोशिश की गई है कि सिस्टम को खराब किया जाए।
अच्छा।
फिर भी व्यवस्थित चल रहा है अभी तक, वो एक बाड़े का ग्लैमर इसलिए और आसपास के दुकानदारों की मेहनत है जो अपना 50 साल 80 साल से काम कर रहे हैं।
I literally crave for this, you know, इधर आने का कुछ अलग ही। अभी तो काफी डर लग रहा है कोविड की वजह से, पर आपने बहुत अच्छा बोला कि लोग अट्रैक्ट होते हैं और सच में होते हैं, और इधर ना हर चीज मिलती है, हर चीज चीप में मिलती है। आपने जस्ट एक बार आओगे और आप हर चीज ले पाओगे, और आप मॉल में थक जाता है इंसान, ऑनलाइन कितना लेगा, वही ब्रांड जो यहाँ का जो हेरिटेज है और सब कुछ है ना कोई नहीं।
यहाँ सबसे बड़ी बात पता है क्या है, आप थैला लो 100 रुपए जेब में डालो, 100 रुपए में भी आपके परचेजिंग हो जाएगी।
एंड ऑल्सो दिवाली पे जो यहाँ पे वो धनतेरस पे होता है, सब आते हैं, सब लोग, मतलब मेरे मामा मामी नोएडा चले गए हैं पर वो लोग आते वाले लोग इधर आते हैं, चाहे जितनी भी भीड़ हो, जितनी भी परेशानी
हो,
बहुत अट्रैक्टिव होता
है। नाउ we came across very hard working and very humble local vendors.
यहाँ पर हम 8-10 लोग बैठते हैं और करीब हम हमारे पिताजी यहाँ पे 40 साल से बैठ रहे हैं। पहले मुझे फुटपाथ हुआ करते थे ऊपर, शहरीकरण के अंदर अब वो तोड़े गए थे सारे। हमारे सामने यहाँ बहुत कुछ बदल गया, सराफा भी 10 फुट पीछे चला गया और हमारा ये रिपेयरिंग वगैरह काम है सारा। और बाड़े पे बहुत कुछ बदलते हुए देखा है हमने।
दिस लेडी टेल्स मी हाउ बाड़ा हेल्प्ड हर।
दीदी देखो, किसी को कष्ट होता है ना, जब कोई आता है, हाँ कष्ट होता है, तो मेरे को जब कष्ट हुआ ना, मेरे को पैसे की जरूरत पड़ी, तो मेरे को इतनी परेशान हो गई थी मैं, फिर मैंने मोजे की दुकान लगाई। मेरे को आज 15 साल हो गए जाते हैं मोजे की दुकान लगाई, तो वो भी है ना उठा लड़ाई चलती रही, उठा लड़ाई चलती रही, उसको लगाते लगाते फिर ना हमारे घर से बोले तुम नहीं जाओ मैं लाऊंगी, फिर मैं ला
उनको बता दीजिए।
देखे क्या है, तो क्या है कि फिर मैंने लगाया तो मौत, फिर मैं आती थी ना परेशान भी होती थी और रोती भी थी, थोड़ा इस लक्ष्मी मैया की इतनी कृपा हुई मेरे पर कि 2 हफ्ते का खाना टाइम से भगवान बंसी वाला दे रहा है, वो दे रहा है, उसकी मैं हमेशा आभारी रहूँगी और लक्ष्मी जी की आभारी रहूँगी इस तरह।
बेसिकली बाड़ा इज ऑल अबाउट वोकल फॉर लोकल। Now these are some very magnificent, very beautiful buildings. Starting from the post office, you can see the traces of Roman architecture in it. The SBI building, it is one of a kind. And the temple, it has so many visitors. And lastly, the government press.
Bada is like dil hai hamare Gwalior ka. Mujhe to lagta hai bachpan se leke aaj tak bada 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 bade ja rahe hain. Hum bas yahi bolte hue bas bade ho gaye. Bachpan se leke bada hi bada bolte hue mamma papa se dada dadi se.
Bada also has a very important historical significance.
Samne post office hai. Uske paas mein State Bank of India hai. स्टेट बैंक का ओल्ड ब्रांच है जो सराफे से कनेक्ट होता है. बहुत सारा यूरोपियन आर्किटेक्चर है जो ब्रिटिश ने बनाया था. जब 1947 का डिवाइडेशन हुआ तो डिवाइडेशन के बाद यहाँ बहुत सारे लोग आए पाकिस्तान से जो रेफ्यूजी थे. तो गवर्नमेंट ने यहाँ पर रोड्स पे जो आप रोड देख रहे हैं इस रोड के ऊपर हम ऐसा सुनते हैं हमने तो नहीं देखा कि यहाँ पर लोग लकड़ी के कमरे छोटे छोटे खोमचे बनाकर बैठते थे जो अपना पूरा बिजनेस करते थे. धीरे धीरे गवर्नमेंट ने उनको रेफ्यूजीज़ को सामने सुभाष मार्केट बना के दिया उनको दुकानें दी. पीछे गांधी मार्केट बना के दी उनको दुकानें दी. इसी तरीके से टोपी बाजार बनाया गया. टोपी बाजार एक प्राइवेट मार्केट है वहाँ पे लोगों ने दुकानें ली और बिजनेस डेवलप किया. बेसिकली जो बाड़ा क्षेत्र है ये पूरा रेफ्यूजी द्वारा बसाया गया है. जो बाहर से आए थे डिवाइडेशन के बाद उन्होंने पूरे इसको डेवलप किया पूरा मार्केट बना. इस वजह से पूरा बाड़ा एक अपने आप में बहुत बड़ा मार्केट बन गया. ये बेसिकली सेंटर ऑफ द सिटी है. वेस्ट से आने वाले लोगों को अगर ईस्ट में जाना है तो उनको बाड़ा क्रॉस करना पड़ता है. साउथ से आने वाले लोगों को नॉर्थ में जाना है तो उनको बाड़ा क्रॉस करना पड़ता
है. आई हैव बीन टू बाड़ा ऑल माय लाइफ ड्यूरिंग ऑल द इंपॉर्टेंट फेस्टिवल्स लाइक दिवाली धनतेरस बट आई नेवर नोटिस्ड सच आर्किटेक्चरल डिटेल्स सच रिच हेरिटेज. दिस एक्सरसाइज हैज ब्रॉट सो मच इन फ्रंट ऑफ मी एंड आई एम सो ग्लैड दैट आई एम इन दिस सिटी.
Okay. Thank you, Rashi, for this very beautiful, walkthrough through the city, old city, and it feels like as if you already visited that place.
Actually, while I was doing this project, you always have a narrative in mind that I need to explore the video in this way, or I need to show people this entire place in a certain manner. So while I was recording all these people's experiences, so I came back home and I thought that, I should convert it into English and then narrate my own story behind the video. And, but then, after removing those people, the essence left. And the essence that the local vendors were telling all of their stories, how they experienced the nitty-gritties, or when the street got shifted, when Sarafa got shifted behind because of new government rules or everything. So how they experienced it themselves. So I wanted to, do justice to them. And in that way, I thought my narrative would look better if the local people were experiencing it in their own personal way.
No, it's very beautifully brought out, that the essence of the place and actually, how each one of the person who's visiting or his livelihood is dependent on that place actually, has some kind of a memory, good or bad, associated with that place. And that is what draws them to that particular place again and again.
Right.
Yeah.
Because when you visit a mall, you don't have a memory attached to it. You really don't. You just go there and shop and come back. But over here, when you cross the streets, when you hear the sounds of the siren, the children playing, the flowers being, the vendors, coming here and there, you that gets to you. And you remember it for a long time.
That's a very important point that you brought out. Even if we go to the mall every time, the memories are the same. I don't think you will even remember that.
They're the same concrete structures, laid out in a proper manner.
Yeah. So I will now invite Smita to actually, take us further down into the other streets of Gwalior and explore how the Maharaj Bada actually connects with the city.
Yes, thanks, Urvashi. And let me just share my screen. Let me know if it gets shared.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you see it?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Okay. Excellent. So yeah, I also want to thank Rashi for this beautiful journey she took us through, enriched with so much local perspective, and in particular how the Bada has accommodated informality and transformation within its formal lines. Before I launch into the presentation, I wanted to thank my aunt, Dr. Rajni Singh, who is in the audience. She was born and brought up next to the Bada and has helped me thread this narrative together. As Rashi said, Bada is indeed the beating heart of Gwalior. And to add to that, Gwalior's soul can be found in its music. And if you have heard the Dhrupad rags, you should know this already. This is the Dhrupad Maestro Mia Tansen with his guru Haridas. According to Pierre Nora, places of memory are those places, refer to those places where memory crystallizes and secretes itself. The places where the exhausted capital of collective memory condenses and is expressed. So let us examine how the Bada is a place of memory, which means how is it a place that contains the collective memory and in turn forms individual memories, thus forming or lending to the identity of the individual and the place. I will start with my individual memory as a 7-year-old. I was born and grew up in a naval cantonment. My father hails from UP, but he studied in Gwalior, and his extended family lives in Gwalior, and he studied at the Sindhya School and College. So in the summer, we would get onto the Punjab Mail, travel overnight to Gwalior, and on the way, the landscape of the Chambal ravines of the famous Dakus got embedded forever in my mind. Having arrived in Gwalior, I was flooded with a sensory experience, especially of markets around the Bada, such as the huge halwai cooling his milk in his shop at Dahi Mandi. My choti dadi was a gifted storyteller and embellished my memories and imagination with a collective lore of Gwalior, including poems and stories of Rani of Jhansi, Tansen, Mrignani, and Dhola Maru. Now let's untangle the threads of the collective memory of Gwalior, which are filling up Maharaj Bada. And I've done it through the layers of topography, history, lore, and culture. This is Gwalior, situated in a valley surrounded by rocky outcrops in three directions. These are crops of the Vindhyachal, the Chambal running in the north and the Sindh River in the south, and their tributaries dissecting the land. The original settlement would have originated around one of these tributaries called Swan Rekha, followed by the establishment of Gwalior as a fort city on this hill called Gopachal Hill. And so two protagonists emerge that dominate the collective memory of the landscape, Gopachal Hill and the river Swarnarekha. In the story of Surat Sen and Sage Gwal, a lost prince Surat Sen was led to the river by Sage Gwal to drink its sweet water. The water cured the prince of his leprosy. And to pay off his debt of gratitude, he built the fort on Gopachal Hill to protect the yogis from the elements and named the fort and his settlement after Sage Gwal. And hence the city got the name Gwalior. We see that the landscape dominates the physical growth of the city as well. Is the slide visible fully or is it getting cut off?
No, yeah, it's visible.
Okay. We see that the landscape dominates the physical growth of the city. For 1800 years, the city was confined to the fort and plains below north of the hill and close to the river, which is here. Whoever captured the hill fort ruled the city. Except for a brief period between 11th and 13th century, the city mostly remained with Hindu rulers. In the 18th century, the Shinde or the Sindhyas captured the fort and became rulers of Gwalior state. They established Lashkar, which means army, south of Gopachal Hill, all the while maintaining a love-hate relationship with the British, who meanwhile established their cantonment along Murar River in the east. The Indian War of Independence in 1858 happens. And Gwalior gets its notoriety of having deserted the Rani of Jhansi, who has to leap off the fort on her horse Badal to escape the British. The city fills in between the gaps. The rail arrives in 1904, and many important civic and educational institutions get established by the Sindhias. Then in 1948, the princely state accedes to the new nation of India, and the princely state merges into the state of Madhya Pradesh, and Gwalior becomes a city devoid of its statehood and loses its royal patronage of art and craft. In terms of culture, if we have to trace culture along the same lines, the actual coins and inscriptions of Mehrukul found in Gwalior date back from 5th century. The rock cut Jain Tirthankars were built continuously from the 6th century to 15th century, depending on the patronage received. The Gurjar Pratihars of the 9th century and the Kachapa Ghats in the 11th century did most of the building during this time. They built the temples, famous of which is the Telimandir of 9th century, commissioned by Raja Mehr Bhoj, and the Sas Bahu temple built by the Kachapa Ghats. Then comes the 14th century. In 14th century, the Tomar Rajputs captured the fort, and a golden era of patronage again starts for arts and crafts. Mansingh Tomar of 15th century is given the most credit for this period, not only for ushering in excellence in art, craft, and architecture, but for protecting and promoting the musical soul of Gwalior in the form of Drupad, and his own testament of love to in the form of Gurjari Palace for Mrigneni. This is the Gurjari Palace, which is below the hill. During this time, the soulfulness of Gwalior was also being enriched by the famous Sufis of Gwalior. The period of Sindhia started in 1730s, and they continued the tradition of patronage to arts and crafts in their buildings and brought in many Western influences. The Gwalior Khayal music with its Ashtanga Gayaki took shape and flourished. The arts touched and extended to the citizens with week-long city festivals like Holi and Dashera, celebrated with food, color, dance, music, which the whole city joined in. Finally, coming to the Bada. I just wanted to play this old video, which shows the Bada and the procession which took place in the Bada under the Sindhias. This is the royal procession leaving Jai Vilas.
Sorry to interrupt, but I think you will have to share again in order to play the
video. Okay, I'm so sorry. All right, let me see. Is it visible now, the video?
Yes.
Yeah, you can make it full screen now.
Yeah, let me just set the playback speed, otherwise we'll be here for a long time. Okay. So I'll just take you to the part where they were at the Bada. Yeah, so now you can see the Bada clearly in the background. I know, Rashi, you can identify it.
Yes, completely.
Yeah. And then I'll go to the part where, yeah, so these are all the entire city watching the procession, the Dashera procession, basically, this is. And we can stop it here. Is the presentation visible again?
Yes.
Okay. Right. So the idea was to show how the BADA was operating as a civic space during the Sindhias in the early 1900s. And so now here, coming back to the BADA, the Maharaja's BADA, or basically an enclosure, was built over the late 1800s. All the way to the early 1900s, separate buildings got built at different points in time. And they were lined with many important civic institutions of the time, which Rashi has already taken us through, which included the Opera House, Post Office, Library, Press, Bank, and very important markets. The markets, like Rashi has told us, there's the Victoria Market, Subhash Market, Gandhi Market, and then the markets going towards spreading out as markets in the streets, which is Sarafa Bazaar and Topi Bazaar. And here is the land use plan. So one can appreciate the amount of mixed use happening here, including temples and dargahs, which are part of the Gorkhi Palace and the temple here. And these temples and dargahs are the ones which get activated during festivals and really activate the space during the festival time. Now, in terms of design principles, the BADA shares many of its principles with the squares of European cities from which it was inspired, no doubt. For example, you can see similarities in the dimensions, in the in terms of 2D across the different plazas, which include Trafalgar Square. Here I've given as an example Plaza de Mayo, Marienplatz, and hitting the magical number of 70 by 100 meters or 100 meters by smaller 50 meters, but remaining in that realm. And the idea of the visual focus, which is there in all of these plazas. And most importantly, the edge detail of these buildings, which interface directly with the plaza in a highly interactive public edge condition. And we can extract these principles as tools for design, really, and tools for design in terms of orientation, human scale, foci, diversity, variety, edge condition, detail, porosity, and density. To give you an example of how human scale has been used in the BADA, this is a space with a dimension of 100 meters by about 70 meters, which is quite the right proportion if you want to see all the activity in the BADA from anywhere. Then you approach another number or threshold, which is 25 to 30 meters, which is about the distance which is maintained from the center to the edges of the buildings. And then less than 25 meters, which are the interactions happening along the edges, and about a 1 kilometer building frontage, which lines the BADA, where really the richness in detail can be taken in, as Rashi said very nicely about all the richness in detail, which can be appreciated at that scale. And most importantly, and which I find extremely fascinating, even while I was there, was the edge activation, which has been done. In terms of the stairs, in terms of podiums, et cetera, on which you can really sit and interact and view and reflect and sort of meet and greet people, these details which are part of the public space. The other tools which have been used extremely well are density, diversity, and porosity. It's a highly porous square, which is being accessed from the surrounding market streets and mixed use streets. The diversity is maintained. It's not dead at any time. It's fully active. And the density, of course, in terms of, you know, from low to high as you proceed inwards. In terms of variety and detail, Rashi has already gone through this. These are different styles of architecture with various elements. And when viewed at the viewing distances of, you know, 10 meters, 10 to 20 meters, you can really, or below, you can really appreciate all the detail, which adds to the variety, the richness of the experience. So all of this, I mean, it basically culminates in a vibrant public space. And we go back to what are the functions of a vibrant public space. It is to meet, interact, connect with people in a safe and secure environment, to see vulnerabilities, to make choices, be entertained, to see and be seen, so to speak, to express delight and celebrate. And most importantly, to join the continuum of a collective memory that secretes into this collective space, giving us our memory and identity. And the whole idea or the whole reason for going through this entire journey was to show you this continuum of the collective memory. And so we see that the Bada, in fact, is a perfect container of the collective memory pouring in with all its humanity. And this memory, I've sort of listed it out. This is the memory of the land, the subconscious physical archetypes, the memories of a common past, time, history, lore, the related ethical values which emerge from these history and lore, which are the morals of the story, so to speak, the memories of common events, celebration, festivals, wars, the memories of life events, marriages, celebrations, festivals again, memory of achievements in art, craft, and design, and the memory of vulnerabilities and desires. And so Bada not only becomes a container of these collective memories, but it also then contributes, because of its very good design, it contributes to the building of individual memories of place over here. Thank you, Urvashi and Rashmi, thank you.
Thank you, Smita, for this very, very engaging and detailed, you know, understanding of how, you know, people and places and memories all intertwine together, and over the period, how memories collectively get together and form the larger memory of a place. I will now invite Jay Khande, to, who is a resident of Gwalior, to share his experiences and memories. I think Jay has got disconnected, or... just a minute. So meanwhile, till the time Jay connects with us again, there are a few things, you know, which have come into mind while I was listening to both Rashi and Smita. Rashi, you mentioned that this is a highly commercialized space where, you know, main land use in terms of usage is commercial activity. But it also is a mixed land use space where different other activities also, like Smita mentioned, there is a temple, there is a dargah, which actually get activated at different periods of time. So what are these other, you know, activities that you have seen happening in the Bada? And what are the social spaces that you can identify within the larger precinct?
So one of the very most important social spaces, like the edge conditions, like we just saw in the presentation, you know, how the edges are activated like beside the buildings, because there is a lot going on even on the outside of it, not just on the inside or the street part of it. So people are, you know, there is a lot of congestion due to parking. So people prefer walking inside that part rather than bringing in their vehicles. So when these social or cultural interactions happen, like with the temple or the dargah, people are always on the edge of these buildings, and there are vendors who are, you know, roaming around that place. So it's kind of a mix between both of these interactions, because, you know, different parts of the place are activated at different times of the day. For example, you will see a lot of people near the post office in the morning hours, or you will see more people in the, you know, the Sarafa or the Rupi Bazaar part in the evening hours of the day. So it's kind of cumulates it all together. And that's how I think the social and cultural interaction takes place.
Yeah, yeah. And also, you know, there is a lot of vending activity, a lot of hawkers, you know, have been occupying spaces within the Bada. What is the nature of these vending activities, and how do they connect to the other, you know, commercial activities which are happening there?
So I saw a sort of hierarchy in that, you know, in that phase, because, you know, the vendors were sitting on the on the edge most part of the road where the vehicles are there, basically on the edge, on the last part of the road. And then there comes the smaller shops, and then behind them the bigger buildings come. So there is a sort of hierarchy which has been maintained by all of them. And you know, they have this they have this understanding between them that this particular part has to be occupied with these vendors, because they don't want to, you know, kill each other's business. They want everyone to cherish in that way. They have built up a community. And like in the video also, you know, one of the vendors, he was telling me that the government do not support them a lot. They don't try to, you know, help them out with the traffic, help them out with the congestion. So the people of Bada, they automatically connect each other and cherish each other in a way. And they also organize the festival, like we have talked about, you know, Dhanteras. So they all, you know, contribute in that. They all collect money for it. So they do not try to, you know, overpower each other. And they always try to bring everyone at the upfront and not try to shadow anyone in that way. So they have maintained the hierarchy, and there are a set of rules. Bada follows their own set of rules in a traditional manner, so as to maintain that.
Yeah, and I think there is also an ecology of even commercial activity. For example, certain things which are available in the main Sarafa Bazaar, there'll be, you know, these small local vendors also who cater to a different kind of a clientele, and also, you know, who will take up like small, the guy was mentioning in your video, how he's doing a repair shop, you know, he's setting up a small repair shop, which the bigger shops may not, you know, undertake those kind of jobs. But so that is the important, that, you know, there is a need for different types of, you know, people doing, engaged in a particular activity. And we need to provide some space for these, you know, people as well, rather than, you know, calling them as encroachers and, you know, something which has to be done away in our, you know.
I think that is actually an habit. It is inside the people of Gwalior also, because Bada is basically in Lashkar. And but people are, like, you know, Gwalior is a larger part. So people from Murar or people from the other parts of Gwalior, they also come to Bada only, you know, for their small tasks or their small, like, which cannot be done on their local area. So it has kind of evolved in a way where you can, you know, get everything done either on the one part or the other part of it.
Yeah, true. Smita, you were mentioning about, you know, how the Bada started to develop from the 1890s or I think 1850s rather, and how different, you know, buildings came up at different period in time. So could you share with us how this transformation would have, taken place, and how over the years the Bada has transformed in terms of the, you know, the change in the land use or the intensity of activities which is happening there, how, you know, the space from being a more pedestrianized space is actually now being overtaken by the vehicular mode of transport, and how the pedestrians and, you know, other people have been kind of marginalized in this space.
So, like, I think you've said it already. That's exactly what has happened. So I started with the whole idea of the design of the space, which is actually a human scale. It is built for pedestrians, and it is built from that perspective. And then, with the advent of the automobile, which has overtaken everything, it has overtaken the civic square also. And I think the struggle between the carriageway and what should be space for all other activities, which include the informal activities that you said, it becomes a struggle. It becomes a contest of space between these. So that is very visible, the contest of space between the informal, the formal, and the traffic. So that's one part of it. The second part of it, transformation overall. I think the Bada, because from its inception or from its origination, started with these very civic buildings, which have a lot of, firstly, they were government owned or transferred to the government. And because of their architectural presence themselves, they have been able to sustain the space pretty much. They've not been so susceptible to transformation that you see, let's say, in other parts of cities where certain squares have transformed and they've become unrecognizable. These buildings have not. And therefore, the character somewhat has remained intact, even though the usage of these buildings has declined. Right? So they've transformed, the usage has transformed or declined. And so I think that aspect, the Bada itself has remained more intact in that aspect. And I think we see that in the smart city proposals also, which where they're trying to think about adaptive reuse of these large 4 or 5 large structures, which lend character to this space. I don't know if I answered. Yeah,
true. In fact, you know, I was also wondering that the Jivaji Chowk, which is the center of the Bada, you know, Rashi, could you just share your, you know, idea about whether this was always designed as a park in the center, or was it more like a, you know, hard landscape and later on was converted because of, you know, management of traffic and all? Was it converted into a central park kind of a thing, or?
Yes, I think it was converted into a central park sort of a thing, because they wanted a visual foci, like, you know, we saw in the design principles. They wanted a focus to be there so that, you know, the places around it can come out, that come up in a better way. We study a lot about the importance of squares or the importance of a, you know, a vantage point in a particular place, because, you know, that guides along the construction of other things around it, because we consider context a lot. And in that way, I feel like, you know, it was constructed so as to guide the construction which are happening along it. And it also, you know, divides the entire place into, you know, 4 or 5 parts of it. It kind of, you know, circulates the entire area and connects it and binds it in a way.
Yeah. So, in, you know, if we are talking about walkability, about, you know, pedestrian movement in that space, you know, this question is to both, you know, Rashi and Smita. Is there a possibility that this space can be reclaimed, you know, maybe, you know, I don't know whether on a temporary basis or a permanent basis? Is there a possibility? Are there options where, you know, the traffic can be managed so that a large part of the central space can be reclaimed as a public space, which is more sociable?
So I think Neeraj is in the audience and he has worked on the pedestrian proposal for Maharaj Bada. If he could unmute himself and talk a little bit about it, I think it's a great, it would be a great way of reclaiming space.
Yeah, thanks, Smita. So I'm Neeraj Bhagat, I'm a conservation architect, and we were the heritage consultants for the Gwalior Smart City, which drew up the proposal for the pedestrianization of Maharaj Bada area. So I think it was sometime 2 years ago, we had prepared this proposal where the traffic had to, was planned to be made unidirectional. I think if I remember correctly, from Sarafa Bazaar, it goes one way, and then from Madhav Ganj or Daulat Ganj, it was that it comes. And then the whole square was to be restricted for traffic entrance. So even though our contract has ended, but the proposal, because of a lot of political changes, change of guard, so it has seen the light of the day. Now I think the tender eventually got awarded, and L&T has been awarded the tender to undertake the pedestrianization work. So I understand there have been few changes, including I recall one meeting where it was suggested that the Bada, the main square area, it was proposed that we plant trees because it was discussed that because of interference, eventually the plan tend to fail. So we wanted a watertight design intervention so that no matter if it's a VIP or they can't utilize this space for driving. So we drew up a proposal where we placed trees on a grid, so which could also support these informal activities. So that is the latest I know, which is being developed, which is a modern intervention. So that was it. And also Gwalior, along with Jaipur and perhaps Agra, is one of the smart cities which has a big chunk of heritage component into it. And the old town of Lashkar and Maharaj Bada area specifically formed a lot of focus for the smart city. So we also undertook the facade improvement of these classical buildings that form the post office, the state bank buildings, the town hall, the Gorky gates. So any Gwalior resident would see that, you know, those all these facades have been spruced up over the last couple of years. So for example, I think the most prominent one is the post office, which was painted that ugly red and white color of the post office. So we have removed that and revealed the original stone surface that you see. So we had also proposed to put, you still have those ugly glass rear, the metal grill gates. We had proposed to put glazing, but I think the authorities decided against it. Then also right next to the Victoria Market, there used to be one small office building, which we converted to tourist information center. So one adaptive reuse example happened there. So I don't know if I'm digressing. So yeah, but pedestrianization, I think they are planning to put trees on a grid within the main square area so that it permanently becomes traffic free. So that's one design intervention, which is bold. I'm happy to be part of that because that's what I think Mr. Sindhya, actually, you suggested that because he said eventually one change of government or something, the bollards could go away and traffic reintroduced. So you create a permanent design intervention so that, you know, which is hard to be removed. So that I'm not aware because we are no longer associated, but I guess that's the last design that I'm aware of towards pedestrianization proposal. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Neeraj, for sharing the, you know, interventions and how the project has been structured. There's a question from the audience. I don't know if Smita, Rashi, or Neeraj, you'd be able to answer that. There's a question about, are there any government schemes under the Street Vendors Act policy of Government of India? So while you were planning, talking about, you know, pedestrianization, were you also considering the street vendors and how to rehabilitate them?
Yes, so there is an act in place with regard to giving recognition to street vendors. So that was one of the constraints of the smart city, which is very, you know, tender focused, that we have to tender this within this time. So I think it wasn't as thorough, I would say, of incorporating the or accommodating the vendors. And we also had asked the municipality if there are any records available. So I think we didn't make much headway into that. But overall, the scheme, there was a discussion where a part of the bureaucracy wanted to do away with the vendors, and they want to, you know, which is the general Babudam approach, is to sanitize and make it swanky. Whereas we as designers had insisted that the vendors stay there. We, you know, make an inventory of the street vendors, how many are there, what are the goods they're selling, and accommodate them within the pedestrianization proposal. So, but I don't know what has been the status in terms of their accommodation in the present scheme. But as far as the design is concerned, there is enough provision to accommodate within the existing proposal.
Yeah, sure. And I think also architect Pavan Sharma has pointed out that, you know, multi-level parking could be thought of as mitigating the parking problem. So I'm sure you must have also talked, while you were talking about pedestrianization, you would have also thought about the parking spaces, which I don't think at the moment is there is any organized parking there?
There used to be, you know, near the library, there used to be a parking space, but it was too small to accommodate the entire, it was not even, it couldn't even accommodate 5% of, you know, the people coming into Bada. So, like what I have seen from my perspective, I don't think that, you know, right now there is a proper parking system. It's just near the, you know, the leftover spaces near the edges, the edge area is, that is being utilized for now. But I think that multi-level parking system can be thought of to, you know, sort of remove the, you know, the congestion a bit, and it can be managed. But I agree, you know, it would be too harsh to not involve the vendors in the pedestrian project, because, you know, my narrative of the video was, you know, to interact with those vendors, the local people. They make up Bada, you know, and not us, like the people living there, people running their livelihoods with that place. So,
yes. So just to add to that, there is a multi-level car parking proposed as part of the pedestrianization proposal. So there is used to be this ground in front of the Gorky school. So as part of the proposal, there was a multi-level, three levels, I think, which is underground parking, which was part of the tender proposal. So I'm assuming that it is being implemented by L&T when they do this project. I think currently the surveys, etc., are currently being done. But if I recall correctly, there are about 300 car park area, and it used and then at the ground level there was an carbon sink park that was to be proposed. So on the at the ground level, you don't see anything. So it's all three level underground car parking. But I think I urge the local Gwalior resident to further, you know, corroborate this information, whatever, because it was 2 years ago that we had prepared this tender proposal.
Okay. Are you aware of that, Rashi?
No.
Okay.
Yes, so I encourage people to write to Smart City or contact and get the information, because this is a huge urban intervention that's been taking place. And I think all Gwalior residents, specifically of people who are residing in that area, should query the local authorities, maybe arrange a public-private meeting as well on this project.
Yes,
yeah.
I completely agree with you. It is very important for the city to, you know, involved in that way. I know about a restoration project that is taking place in Victoria Market, because, you know, when that fire broke out 10 years ago, it was a huge loss for the entire city. So I know, you know, they are converting the Victoria Place into a museum, but not very sure about the parking.
I think it's actually being made extended for the Sarod Bhavan. I think it will be used for musical as a venue for that. And I, you know, so I just wanted to make one point moving away from the projects, was that this is where I feel, I mean, what holds Gwalior together is this, the residents are so mobilized with respect to heritage. And I sort of have seen that in the, you know, in various public consultation exercises also, that the citizens feel so mobilized around ideas of heritage, because it is such an integral part of the collective. And, you know, sort of epitomized, of course, in the Bada. I think, you know, moving on, if these kind of, you know, so again, like Mr. Bhagat said, if the residents kind of, or the citizens kind of mobilize themselves around these ideas, and which is very possible because they feel so much about it, I think pedestrianization of civic spaces will happen more. And I think as a planner, I cannot stress enough on the need for civic spaces. I mean, we have planning norms for open spaces, you know, tot lot, this, that. I think we should have norms for civic spaces. And it doesn't matter whether you have, you know, you have a green in the middle or not. It's just a civic space, an enclosure, a bada. I mean, I think every city needs 3 or 4 badas, depending on the scale. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Just because we also had proposed 3 heritage network trails, separate ones. And I think people can react once, because I'm speaking very much from the smart city perspective. So we were asked to do these heritage network trails, and we divided into phases. So we started with Sarafa Bazaar. So we identified there are about 20 heritage buildings with facade. So what we had planned as part of this network trail was to reintroduce the cobblestone surface so that the traffic is made slower, and also introduce directional informational signage, some heritage lighting. And most importantly, there was money, sufficient funds in the smart city, where we asked the property owners of heritage buildings that if we can improve the heritage facades. So that was the proposal. And as a conservation architect, I thought, okay, people would be just lining up to sign up on this. But surprisingly, everyone refused. So actually, that was the project never took off because we never got the owner's consent. So that was one experience that that remains there, because we were, as the government in this case, was throwing money. Okay, you have this heritage building, we'll do all the facade improvement in facing the street. But they refused. The only condition was that they had to do an undertaking where they would not change it for next 5 years. They were not allowed to, because the fact that government is spending money, so you better not change it immediately. So we wanted that undertaking. And perhaps that was the reason where people didn't want to give away their control for the properties. So maybe others could explain any other reason, because I remain intrigued till today.
But they didn't understand that it would help the business, the local business, their own buildings getting a facelift. They didn't see the pros of all that.
That's my question to you.
I think maybe if you would have been able to take up a pilot, that could have been a more a demonstrative thing. I don't know. It depends.
So we discussed at length at another presentation, because I keep including this example where I was pretty confident. So I tried to connect the dots and drew a parallel with the Chandni Chowk. Again, I've seen some very wealthy people running those shops, but they have a very plain facade. So maybe the reason is more sociological than anything else, because they don't want a fancier facade to attract attention, because I know a lot of people there. So on the exterior, it's very plain, simple, which doesn't draw any attention, but they're in reality, they're very wealthy. So it's just probably over the generations, they prefer anonymity over a swanky facade. I think that was my takeaway from this experience.
That seems like an interesting,
I don't feel like people of the Gwalior are really, not in favor of that. because you know people in the people over here are very extroverted. They like to express themselves. They like to, you know, maintain their heritage a lot. So you know, there are various.
I think you need to go back and see why. Run. Maybe ask people why they wouldn't comply. Maybe yes. I know Sarafa Bazaar has so many of these old buildings still left. Maybe you could talk to some of the owners, Rashi, next time you're there, and try and find out what. Why would they not? Because I mean, all business sense tells me that it is the right business decision. But like Mr. Bhagat is saying, you know, maybe, I don't know, anonymity is, because on the other hand, if you see all, I mean, reading Las Vegas and all that, I mean, retail typically tries to call attention to themselves. And so it's a very contradictory thing. It's an interesting mystery.
In fact, there is an interesting comment by architect Pavan, who's actually talking about, you know, very important issue which is related to ownership, you know, because sometimes these properties have multiple owners, and getting the consent within their family or within the, you know, owners could also be one of the deterrent, I feel, you know. Yeah. Many places I've found that you know, because I have been working in Shekhawati in Rajasthan, so I've found that, you know, their property is owned by, like, you know, at least 50 people. So getting all of them to consent to actually, you know, even if they are getting, you know, funding from the government for a project, is very difficult. Sometimes the even the ownership rights are not clear. So that also becomes an issue.
You know, I see at least, you know, one or twice a month, the traffic change, the routes are changing, you know, this place, different sort of barriers along the city. And you immediately, you know, some politician is coming to the city. So the governments also change, and they try to adjust to what the person in the power wants with that particular city right now. And when they can change the traffic route so easily, like, you know, it was pointed out that Mr. Sindhya pointed out, there should be permanent design changes so that when the governments change, when the governments also, you know, change, it cannot be easily changed into something which it is not intended to be. So there needs to be permanent changes. So maybe people are scared of that permanent change, or they don't want to go into that.
Yeah, so the change is always, there is always a sense of apprehension. So even with pedestrianization, right now you could just go and park outside the shop that you want to visit. But pedestrianization would change that. So now with this consolidated parking in front of Gorky School, which means that even though e-rickshaws or battery-operated cars are part of this pedestrianization, but still people are averse to that change. They don't. They see that, oh, they'll have to walk all the way from Gorky to Sarafa. So, yeah, so there is some our Indian sensibilities as well, which tend to resist this walking culture. So yeah, and also smart city also has a very, it's not very fluid, it's a rigid top-down approach, so there are constraints there as well. So yeah, so I always wish that there was much more public and government interaction. In fact, three owners had consented, and I, as part of the consultant, I said, I tried to plead with the authorities that let's do these three buildings and others may fall suit. But I think in bureaucracy, there is 100 crores or something. They tend to look at the fancy numbers. If it's not 20 crores and just 2 crore tender, then I think they tend to not go ahead. Their enthusiasm greatly reduces.
I know these complications and complexities are always there when one is, you know, working on the ground trying to, you know, bring about changes in what is already existing there. So thank you so much. Thank you, Rashi, for this beautiful video, and Smita for a very interesting presentation. And thanks, Neeraj, for joining in the conversation. Today we have two small little volunteers who are helping me coordinate this session. So I'll request Bhavya and Suhas, can you please share the poster for the next session? The next Play Story session, titled Jaipur World City Market is scheduled for 7th March 2021 from 5 p.m. onwards. Our play storyteller for the session, Ms. Paki Srivastava, will be taking us into the historic core of Jaipur to witness the daily life of the residents of the city unfold within the historic bazaars of Jaipur in all its glory. The place expert for the session, Dr. Vibhuti Sachdev, will take a deeper look into the historic city and the bazaar and explore the memories associated with the place, as well as the connections that people from all walks of life have with the place. Place resident Mr. Arvind will share his personal experiences and memories of the place. So stay tuned for our upcoming play story. I personally thank each one of you for your participation and support to the Festival of Places. Look forward to meeting all of you again next Sunday, same time, same place, for another exciting journey through the landscape of our country. Thank you, everyone.